But yeah, I will talk about machine learning, and it will be a rather broad overview of the machine learning fields with some experience and some insights of what everything around it and so on. So let's see how much I will have time to cover. So first, for the context, of course you might think in this big data is of course a hype right now, I would say, because everyone thinks that, oh, we have so much data, so now there must be a huge value in the data if we just can lure it out somehow, that value. So just because you have a lot of data, you think you can have a lot of value. Unfortunately, it's not so simple, because of course it doesn't. It's not always that. You data never speaks entirely for itself. You always need to understand something about the data, and that's why you can't really do it like this. Just take the data and see what conclusions you can have and what money you can earn from that. You need a model. You always need a model to interpret the data with respect to, kind of. And here I mean model in a very wide sense now, not just machine learning model. So somehow the data is, in the best case, just a small, we call it a trace of the reality, something in the real world, that the data is noisy and maybe incomplete, gives incomplete hints about the things in the real world. And what you have to do is to model the things that are relevant in the real world, and then you use the model to make conclusions and get the answers. And also, to know what to model, what is relevant in the real world, you should need what the question is. What is it you want to know? What are you searching for? Only then can you model the right aspects of the real world. Because it doesn't matter how much data you have, if it's the wrong data, if it's not the data, if it does not contain the information you need to make that big money over here. So, and that's why a model is always important. And now this model is, of course, in a wide sense. You have to understand what you are asking and what you want to, what aspects of the world you want to model, and what answer you're actually looking for, what the task is. But machine learning then is, let's see, machine learning is very relevant here. It comes in as an one important answer to this question, how to model data. That is because, in one sense, machine learning can be defined as using real data, typically, to train a model, as opposed to programming a system by hand. You let it learn from data instead. And then you use that model instead to solve various typically hard tasks, because if they were easy, you would have just programmed them from scratch or solved it by some other method. So typically it's some advanced tasks. I will have a list of some typical tasks in a while. So that is machine learning in a very general sense. First, build your model from some data, then use the model to make conclusions about either new data or just the model itself. That depends a little bit. So typically, what different tasks is typical in machine learning? The most the most general task is maybe classification, because most of the other tasks can usually be formulated in terms of classification. But I'd like to distinguish anyway, a little bit, that in classification you typically have a known, you have data observed through a, you have a number of entities in the world, of course, and those entities have some features that you can observe in your data. And then you want to classify it into different classes. And if you have classification, you typically know what classes you have. And you typically also you have some labeled training data, so you can know which, you have examples of what the different classes look like. And the machine learning task is then to learn this mapping between the features to the class, so you can classify completely new patterns without any label. And that's opposed to clustering, which is, again, you have a number of entities from apparently some different categories or so, but you don't know the categories from start. So the machine learning task here is actually to find reasonable clusters, to find these tentative classes that exists out there in the world. And then, of course, prediction is not much. That can mean a lot of different things, actually. It's an ambiguous word here. It can either mean that whereas in classification you have a... Yeah, it can mean mainly two things, I would put in prediction, two completely different things. One thing is that instead of a categorical class, you have a continuous valued output, which is just like regression or something. So it's not so interesting. The more interesting is a special case when you want to predict is something in the future, like the time it takes for something to happen, or what the next step will be in a process or so. So that can also be meant by that. But these terms are kind of fuzzy and they overlap and so on. And also interesting here is a very hot area is also anomaly detection, which becomes more and more important if you have these huge amounts of data coming in and you need to monitor it to see if everything is okay or if something strange happens. Again,
is it just a classification problem?
You might think that anomaly detection is just a classification because there are two classes, normal and not normal. And so what's the difference? And that's exactly what I was going to tell you. That just like in clustering, you typically don't know the answer. You don't have examples from normal and abnormal. You just have the normal class. You know what it should look normally. And then you try to say that everything else that is not normal, that's an anomaly. So in that sense, it's like clustering and anomaly detection can be said to be, in that sense, more unsupervised. I have not, let's see if I'm going ahead too far ahead in this thing. You're talking about in machine learning, you can have supervised learning when you know the classes or the end results in the training data. So the training data, when you construct your model, then you know the truth, the ground truth, or the answer. Whereas in unsupervised learning, you don't. Like in clustering, you don't know what the real categories are. And in anomaly detection, you have to figure out which cases are anomalous.
Can you say that anomaly is a special case of clustering, or it's not always?
Yes, I could say it's more closely related to clustering, whereas there is some special relations between the clusters here. In clustering, you typically say that each cluster should have a specific mass and be well limited, kind of. In anomaly detection, it might be that the normal class is fairly wide, but fairly delimited. The anomalous class is very broad, very vague, and contains much less examples. Normal class might have 99% of all the cases, and then you have 1% spread out all over the place. So it's a very different kind of clustering, where the clusters are not at all symmetric. So that still makes it special. But it is true, you can use clustering techniques for anomaly detection if you like, or anomaly detection techniques to do clustering. So, and just a few examples. Here, this is a kind of abstract tasks. Here is just a small list. This list might be much, much longer, of course, of actual applications where you can use machine learning. Like medical diagnosis was popular in the beginning, and maybe it's becoming popular again now with computer vision has taken some huge steps forward the recent few years, I would say. Speech recognition has been for a while now, working better and better. Fraud detection, that's an example of where anomaly detection can be used, for example, to detect frauds. Various recommended systems, also hot area now. Sales prediction, yeah. And there are, this list can be made very, very long, of course, of different possible applications of machine learning. So there is a huge, in this world of big data with huge data sets that you can't go through manually, so you need some automated methods, and a lot of application areas where you actually can use these things. I think that machine learning is an area on the rise. It has been active for many years, but now we can see that it's more and more important. So, let's see, what do I have then? Yeah, okay, just an example. Typically, you in machine learning, you, as I already touched upon, you characterize the entities you want to classify. Let me now say, I will talk about classification a lot. I will focus on that, and that is because the other things, the other tasks, they are kind of related to classification more or less. So even if I will focus on classification, but most of what I say actually refer to all of them, so with just minor variations back and forth. So it's just for simplicity, I will say classification and mean more or less all of them. So typically you have a number of input features. So the entities you want to classify are characterized by these a number of features, and then you have, in the supervised case at least, you have this output value, the ground truth, the thing you want to output, which is, or at least in the supervised case, it is given in the training data, whereas in the unsupervised case you might have to deduce it yourself. You don't have any ground truth. So, for example, just a very simple example, just to make it look more simple than it is. Let's consider two features, X1 and X2 here, and two classes, the blue class and the orange class. And this is your training data here. So you have a number of examples of blue and a number of examples of the orange class placed in this coordinate system of the two features, X1 and X2. And then we have a new pattern here, the gray one, which we don't know which class it belongs to. And we want to classify this gray one. So that will be a running example in the following then. However, this is a little bit too simple example. It might lead your mind in a way so you think this is a more simple subject than it is, because the data here, I have two continuous valued attributes, but note that the data might be of very different kinds. You might have just binary or discrete, that is more values than two, but discrete values, of course, or they might be, as in the previous example, continuous valued, of course, or there might be mixtures of some discrete variables and some continuous valued variables. But it doesn't stop there. You might have time series, and then the values are kind of related over time in some way. And these time series if you characterize your thing you want to classify is characterized by a time series, different entities you want to classify might have time series of different lengths. So you can't even store it easily in a fixed length vector. So you need to handle that somehow. I will not go into exactly how to handle that, but it's something to think about. Also, you might have, you think that you have a general method that can handle these some continuous and discrete values, and then suddenly you get natural text. And that again is very different with a very, you might think that all noise, most values are typically continuous, and all noise is typically Gaussian. And then you get free text, and no, it's not Gaussian noise. It's just misspellings, abbreviations, strange characters, completely new words, grammatical errors, syntactic errors, whatever. So it's not a simple noise model. And then, of course, images, where you have a, you might think of it as a huge array of pixels. So that's easy. It's a fixed length array of pixels. Yeah, sure. But the pixels themselves are maybe not suitable as features, as we shall see in later examples. And the same with sound here. Maybe it's not the exact sound wave you should feed in as your feature vector up there. So all these things must be handled. So that complicates the area somewhat. Okay, let's see, where am I now? Yeah. Now, let's start for real. The machine learning area is a huge field, really. And I, as I said, I will only scratch the surface today. So there are a lot of different methods developed over the decades from at least 50 or 60 years from the birth of AI. So let's see. Typically, you can divide the machine learning algorithms coarsely in. I have divided it in five groups. Typically, sometimes it says only four groups, the four first, but I think this is a group of its own. So let's start from the top here. First, we have the case-based methods with typical examples of nearest neighbor is a typical one. So the idea here is very simple in case-based methods. You just store every training pattern you see. So when I talk about training a model, that's just making a huge table. So that's pretty simple training phase, really fast. But it takes a longer time when you want to retrieve a pattern, when you see a new sample and you want to classify it. What you do then is you search through that entire table to find the best match, something that looks the same. And then you say, it must be the same class to the one it looks most similar to. So it builds on the premise that similar patterns probably belong to the same class. Right. So it's simple enough. But that's just one big class, and there are more examples from that than here than I've listed here. The next large class is logical inference, where you can have more based in this reasoning, the AI branches, the hard AI branches of logical reasoning and prologue and so on, where you want to construct expressions, logical expressions characterizing the different entities of each class. So one of the more used and more famous is maybe decision trees, but also the rule-based systems of the 80s. So that's one huge area stemming from the AI, the hard side of AI. Then we have another huge area, of course, artificial neural networks, stemming from the soft side of AI in the early days. I will maybe come back to that The kind of conflict between the soft and the hard AI people in the beginning there. I will go a little bit more into some artificial neural networks later, but there are some. The most well known is probably the multi-layer perceptrons, and the most popular right now is probably the deep neural networks of various kinds. And then we have another huge area of statistical machine learning methods, and there is, this is my area of statistical machine learning, and you can see, because it's a longer list of methods here than under anyone else. And I will talk a little bit more about the statistical methods also. I can say this about this conflict. In the beginning, there were these two, what do you call it? Some 60 years ago, when AI started, there were this kind of conflict between those people that think that you should use that reasoning, that the human mind, we're thinking in logic, like we are reasoning rational, like that. And everything you want to classify should be neatly packaged in square buckets. This is all birds can fly. So if Tweety is a bird, then Tweety can fly. But ostriches are birds, but they cannot fly. So if Tweety is an ostrich, Tweety cannot fly, and so on. Just neatly packaged in square buckets, everything. And then the other part, the more soft part that says, you weigh up different evidence, you take something, well, how big wings does it have, how huge is it, can it run, and you weigh it together, and somehow it's, well, if it's bigger than some threshold, then Tweety probably can fly. So it's more fuzzy, this soft part of it. You just weigh together different evidence and try to say something. And there were a conflict between those schools of early AI. But what has happened during the decades from that is that more and more has actually converged to the statistical parts, because the logical inference went more and more to, for example, thanks to something called Bayesian networks, trying to reason in terms of causalities and the influence different factors had on each other in a probabilistic framework, which was very successful. It still is very successful in many domains, and also with other ways to add statistical or interpretations to their logic formulas. Whereas artificial neural networks also added various statistical interpretation to the weights and the outputs and statistical regularization methods and so on. So formulating many of their artificial neural networks could be formulated like pure statistical methods. So it seems that they started to converge to this area of statistical methods. A lot of machine learning converged here. Until suddenly something, if I may say so, we don't know where it will end yet, but something a little bit surprising happened recently when before the surprising part happened, most neural network conferences were more and more focused on statistical methods. There were a lot of talk about the mixture models and MCMC and kernel density estimator, Bayesian networks. A lot of these things on the mainstream neural network conferences. Until suddenly a number of years ago, this concept of deep neural networks appeared and actually had some very good results in originally computer vision. So then we are a little bit back to neural networks, at least temporarily. I don't know. We'll see what happens. I will say some words about the fifth category, which I think is also an important category of machine learning methods. You might have heard about genetic algorithms, and some people say that actually all these things in this area, that's not really machine learning, it's more optimization. You try to optimize a number of parameters or optimize something. But that's exactly what machine learning is about. You optimize a model to your data. So that in that sense, most of these methods actually are used in the other methods here. Like artificial neural networks, you can, there are some, I think the Boltzmann machines is, okay, now I get uncertain. Is it Boltzmann machine you train? I think you train it by simulated annealing. They was using. Now
it's non-convex, you have to use simulated annealing.
Okay, yeah, exactly. So you can use simulated annealing when training Boltzmann machines, for example. Also, and you can have used genetic algorithms to fit logical expressions or mathematical expressions to some data. So in one sense, these techniques here are important tools within machine learning, whether you call it an own category or not. So I think, but I will nevertheless, I will not focus on this fifth category in the rest. I will actually look a little bit closer on the four first, and you will have this as a background that don't forget it, that it exists, but I will not say so much.
So will you relate each of these sort of methods to some classes of machine learning tasks that is the best to solve with that specific method?
You might hope that I would. Let's see how much I will tell you. Let's see. I can't promise anything. It's not so easy. But let's dive down a little bit more in each of these then. First, the case-based methods. As I already said, the main idea is that similar patterns belong to the same class. So here, example, I have tried to illustrate a k nearest neighbor method where k is 3, that means you take the 3 closest neighbors to this gray unknown one, the one you want to classify, and then they vote. So you say that 2 of the 3 closest ones are orange, so this method would classify this one as orange. Simple enough. So as I said, easy to train. But note this, if you save all the training patterns, this will increase with the training pattern seen. So in a big data context, if you have streaming data coming all the time, your model will grow linearly with time, which might not be feasible. And so will the retrieval time, unless you have some, okay. You will need anyway, some smart indexing method to actually retrieve the most similar ones. So that one need not take increased time as much. But anyway, this might be one drawback in a big data context. Also, it requires specification of a distance measure. And that's easy to miss if you have such a simple picture here. You can see the distance here, it's no problem. But as I said, if these dimensions measure completely different things, you might have weight and age or something. How are you comparing weight and age? Is one kilogram worth 1 year of difference? So, or should you take... Yeah, how do you even compare it? So you must design your distance measure to reflect that. And now, of course, you can get help from information theory and try to model what is a... You can make whitening of the data, for example, so you make sure that data has the same variance in every single attribute or feature. But still, it's tricky. You must do something, you must consider this. And some features might be completely irrelevant, and then they will disturb the distance measure. Whereas, say that you have 2 features that are really important for your classification and 10 features that are not, that are just noise. And if you use a distance measure in that space equally, even if you use whitening, and if you say, I've used whitening, so now it's okay, those 10 ones will destroy the rest. So you have to be careful. The positive, on the positive side, which I actually should have written it down, I forgot it, sorry, so you have to take a note to say something positive about this area. You don't need to know much about the shape of these distributions. Okay, you need to specify a distance measure, but you need not to know anything about if is this space structured in some way, or is it very complicated? Maybe the classes are like filaments going back and forth, kind of, in this space, or something like that. That is very might be very hard to capture with other methods, whereas case-based doesn't matter. Just if you have sufficiently many training data to cover the strange formed structure in space here, then it will work. So that's a big pro of the case-based one. You don't need to know anything else about the structure of the space.
But isn't that it would depend whether you'd be efficient with your model or not? So if it is very complex, then you might either if you start at the wrong position, you might have a too complicated model, and then this is the
model. Just made a distance.
Exactly. Here, the model is a set of training data, and that's the point. The other models have the problem you are saying. So that is the point. Okay. So then you have some view of case-based methods, and also pros and cons. You can use it without knowledge of the strange shapes of the world, but you need to be aware if you have a lot of data, streaming data. You have to actually select probably some subset, representative subset of the data, otherwise it will be unfeasible. Any other questions on this case-based? Or I will...
Yeah, let's go
on, yeah. So, the next category I mentioned was this logical inference. So, as I said, here we want to construct logical expressions to characterize the different classes. So in this example, one common example is a decision tree. So it might look like this, for example, that first you check axis one for some value here. Let's say that this value is 3.5 here on this axis. So if it's bigger, you go to this, I should have said this is a yes arrow and this is a no arrow. And if it's not bigger, then it's on this side, and then you come to a leaf, and the leaf says it's the blue class. Otherwise, you check x2 instead. If that's bigger than, say, 1.8 here, if it's no, then it's the blue class. If it's yes, then it's the orange class. And everything is neatly organized in squares, as I said. Or typically, at least in the simple case, you consider one feature at a time. Of course, you can make extensions to handle a few features at a time, but typically. So in this case, the unknown here would be classified as blue. What's the pros and cons here? This is a more compact model, as you can see. When you get more and more training data, the model not necessarily grow. You don't store every single data point. You can throw away your training data, but you need to maybe I will say something.
Refine this tree.
Exactly. It might be hard to refine. It might be hard because what you do typically when you train this, you can use, for example, information theory to find out which features are mostly relevant to distinguish the different classes. And the most relevant feature you will put as a first node here. And then the second relevant will be the second node and so on. And then you divide your way down into the leaves. But if you want to adjust it, when you get some new data, you should preferably calculate those information for all the previous data. So it might not be easy, at least it might be possible. I'm not an expert on decision trees. So there might be elaborate methods to deal with this that I don't know about. But at least that's something you need to handle.
Do we decide the features on the top based on correlation or what? Like
for example, here you wrote x1, so how do we decide?
Yes, it's on a correlation or, for example, mutual information. You want to select the limit here that, in your words, gives a maximum correlation, of course, between the feature and the class distribution. Although, if the classes are not continuous value or binary, then you can't talk about correlation, then you talk about information, mutual information instead. That's more general, but it's the same conceptually.
What do you do if the features are related, correlated?
X1 and X2?
The covariance is not zero.
Now, in this, you don't have to do anything.
You don't have to do principal component analysis.
You may, of course, but that comes in the next chapter. but that's true. But in its basic shape, you don't do that. You can just use the features. What can I say? So it might be hard to adjust these incrementally. That is one negative thing. But a positive thing might be that it's a simple expression that anyone can understand. This is not a hidden black box method. You can actually read out the rules and see, that's why we belong to this class. And many rules are still written like, there are many rules in real world written like this. For example, medical diagnosis. If the blood pressure is above this and the glucose level is below this, then it's you get this diagnosis and go on to page 15 to see what you should do. So many such diagnoses are still expressed in this way. And decision trees are still used a lot in industry to diagnose equipment. So a lot of equipment manufacturers maintain decision trees for troubleshooting of their systems. So this, I would say this is the most widely used in industry machine learning method, I would say, as far as I know. Any other questions on logical inference? Oh, I'm going on a huge speed here.
No, that's fine.
Okay. So let's dive down into this artificial neural networks, which is also a huge area. Of course, the name neural networks hints that the inspiration is from actually the brain. So this was in the beginning of AI, when this conflict between the logical and the hard or the soft parts of AI, then of course, whereas logic people said that humans are reasoning with logic, the soft people said, no, let's look at how the brain is built instead. The brain, we should not, that's on a high, on a too high level to reason with logic. That's a very, very high thing. That's not so useful when doing things that are hard for computers to do, but easy for humans, like recognizing an apple or learning language or reading text or something like that. These things are rather hard to do by logic, really. So we must look at the more low-level perceptual things here. And then we should look at how the brain is built. And the brain is actually built like neurons. And here I drew them as artificial neurons, not real neurons. But each neuron has a number of connections from other neurons. So each of these neurons send signals up to that neuron, and they are weighted together with a weight matrix here representing this layer of weight. So this unit adds up the signals from the other units weighted by these weights, and if it's above some threshold, then the real biological neuron then gives a spike that is a new signal out to the neurons it is connected to in turn. And of course, there is not... then we make, how to put it, in the artificial neural networks, you typically not have spiking units. You have continuous valued units between 0 and 1, and they may have some non-linear activation function that transfers this sum of the inputs into an output, typically using a sigmoid function that starts at 0 and ends at 1, for example. That is actually, then you might think that's a difference to the human brain, but actually, if you look closely at the brain is organized in, these neurons in the brain are organized, I should have had some picture of that, of course, in something called microcolumns of say, some 100 or so neurons responding to the same feature. So there are not a single neuron responding to a single input, but 100 neurons. And if you average them, each of them will give spikes. But if you average them, you will see something called an activity level, which can be lower or higher. So actually, each of these artificial neurons are more similar to a microcolumn of neurons in the brain. And then, of course, in the first... what should I say? In the first neural network architectures, you stacked these layer-wise. So first you have an input layer. It sends its input to a hidden layer here, and the hidden layer sends it to an output layer, for example, or more hidden layers, if you like. In the brain, there are many, many layers. And another difference is that in the brain, it's not so simple. It's not just going forward, it's going backward. A lot of actually, the feedback connections are far more than the forward connections in the brain. And another thing, in the first neural networks you constructed, maybe a few that was before the big data age and before the massive graphical processors to do things. So then typical neural networks were a few hundred units or maybe 1,000 units. That was a lot on that time. That was, was it 30 years ago or something. And that should be compared and then you could do fairly advanced stuff with such neural networks. They could learn to do some advanced classifications, controlling machinery and diagnosing grains or something.
Character recognition,
some simple form of character recognition. Yeah, and typically then in those days you had typically one or at most two hidden layers in these neural networks. That has fortunately changed now, but and there were a big hype around these neural networks that they could solve everything now, and you don't have to understand your problem. You can just train your neural network and it will solve your problem for you. And still, if we go back and consider the brain, then let's consider a very small part of the brain, our eye. The retina of our eye is technically part of the brain because it's connected with a direct wire to the rest of the brain. But actually, before actually going into the brain proper, in the retina of the brain, there are 7 layers of neurons already, and there are about 10 million sensors, 10 million light-sensitive cones and rods in the retina. Which is far outnumbering the few thousand units in those networks. And on its way through those 7 layers, the input picture is, compressed tenfold. So there are only 1 million lines going into the brain in the nerve connecting the eye to this nerve bundle connecting it to the visual cortex. So there is a lot of processing done in the retina. For example, contrast enhancement and even movement, movement detection and compression of the image. So there is a lot of so even the small patch, say a small square millimeter of our retina is far more complex than those early neural networks that there was so much hype about, just as a contrast. What more to say? Yeah, I will actually say something. I'm going back and forward here and telling various things. Another interesting thing between now I'm painting this conflict between the logic and the hard and the soft AI people in the beginning, and saying that the logic people, they were actually, it seems they were not paying attention to the actual brain, but they were. They were just interpreting it differently. So actually, some inspiration for this logic reasoning came also from the brain, because clearly you see that this is a unit, and the unit takes as input a number of other units, and if the sum of these units is above some threshold, then it's give a spike. And a spike, that's a one or a zero, a truth value, true or false. And by modifying the threshold here, if you have a low threshold, then you get an OR gate that triggers whenever a single input comes. And if you have a high threshold here, then you get an AND gate that requires all of the inputs to be on to get a spike out. So actually, that is proof that the brain is actually working as a network of logical gates. That was the interpretation of the brain at that time, in the 60 years ago. So everyone took inspiration from the brain, but in different directions, kind of. So, I should say something more. I have now just told you a lot of anecdotes and things. So, let's look how this works. Look at this picture and so on. Now, I must confess, this is a straight line. That is what you would get with a one-layer neural network. If you only had one weight matrix here. And the way to achieve that line in that case, I will start with that simple case here, is to, you start with some random weight matrix, probably the wrong, each weight matrix here will correspond to a discrimination line through space. On one side of the line you will get one, this unit will give a spike, and on the other line it will not give a spike. And you can easily see that by linear algebra. If you have a single weight vector to this unit from the other units, that weight vector will be the orthogonal to this discrimination line. Do you see that? Because you will get the same, you will get like equivalue lines here, orthogonal to your weight vector. So with a single layer network, you can only have straight discrimination lines through this space. And in this case, what you do is, typically in the most common network, the error backpropagation network, you start with random weights, and then you input your training patterns and the result, and you see, for each pattern you see, was it wrong or right? Because now, if you have a random weight vector, the network will just guess. So you will get a random guess. So of course it will be wrong. Then you adjust your weight slightly in the direction that will make the answer more correct next time. And then you take the next pattern. Is it right or wrong? Probably it's wrong. So you adjust your weights to get a more correct answer for that specific pattern. And then you go through the training data, and then you go through it again and again and again. And each time you go through the training data, it will converge to get a better and better guesses on each class. And that is called error backpropagation. You take the error between what the network guessed and what you would have liked, and you propagate it backwards through the weight vectors to adjust it to make better next time. So you gradually adjust a line to discriminate between the two classes. In this case, of course, this unknown will be blue with this one-layer network. If you have a non-linear transfer function, which is important, and several layers, then you can get more complex discrimination lines. So you could be able to actually, this one could as well be orange if you have a discrimination line like that, for example. So that's how it works.
So before you go further, do you consider like linear regression and logistic regression as just one layer neural network, or what is it?
There is a relation between a one-layer network and linear regression, but it's not exactly the same, because still, typically, they are equivalent in capacity, that if you can solve the problem with a one-layer network, theoretically, you can solve it with linear regression, and vice versa. So they are equivalent in expressive power. But there are some cases when linear regression would make something wrong, where, for example, a one-layer perceptron would get it right. And that is if, less wrong, I would say. If there is, I think...
But if it's linear, both of them are linear, how can it be different?
Let's see. I'm trying to figure out an example. It can be because a neural network is more, it can try all possible lines. And even if the line in linear regression, you will try to consider all values far away. Whereas this, when fitting this line, you will only consider the ones that are getting wrong, that are close to the line. So they are not considering, they are not paying equally weight to all training patterns. And that then it might be the case that there are some outliers far away that fools the linear regression method, but you actually manage to squeeze the line somehow, so you are not equally fooled. So it's more, the neural network is slightly more flexible in that.
I mean, the linear regression is still, it's a convex minimization problem.
Yeah, so if the two classes are linearly separable, these aren't. There is one orange here, which might be noise. So, but if they are linearly separable, then they will both find the correct solution. Yes, then they are equivalent. But in the cases when they are not linearly separable, they are not guaranteed to give the same result. That's a good question. Typically, there are plenty of different neural network architectures. But yes, you need a lot of training data to train a neural network, specifically if it has more than one or more hidden layers. If it's a one-layer neural network, then it doesn't matter. Then it, as the regression method, it will kind of find it, even if you have a few data. But as soon as you have more layers, you will have more expressive power. And then I will mention something in just a while about something called overtraining. That if you have a complex model with a lot of free parameters, then you need a lot of more data to get those parameters right. The more free parameters you have, the more training data you need to get good values for them, of course. And so with a more powerful network, and especially with more and more layers, you need magnitudes of more data, which makes these suitable in a big data context, because suddenly you have a lot of data, data that you didn't have before, in addition a lot of higher computational power, so you can actually train these, and so on. And that is, yeah, it says here, especially these deep architectures, when you have a lot of hidden layers, they rely on that you have a lot of data, which is actually positive in the big data case.
to sort of make sure that the result we're getting is what we want. For example, artificial neural networks, as well as using one of the other methods?
Yes.
Or is that an overkill, or you basically, depending on the data at hand, you have to choose one?
You should be open to use several methods. Not all methods doesn't fit all kinds of data. So there is some kind of rules, rule of thumb you can use, but they are not so concrete. That's why I will not delve into those rules very much. But yes, it certainly makes sense to, if two different machine learning paradigms lend themselves seemingly equally well to this task, you can try both, of course. It's a little bit like that. But I think I will come a little bit more to that later. What could I say? Yeah, these are also a good thing about artificial neural networks is that they can typically, if you do it right, you can learn them incrementally. When you get streaming data and more data, you can adjust them gradually to the new data. And also, if you actually have, as I said, in this backprop algorithm, you are running through, iterating through your data set over and over again until it has converged. If you actually have a never-ending stream of novel data all the time, you might not even need to iterate. You can just take that data, look at it, throw it away afterwards. Why would you iterate? You get more and more data every time, and that is much, much better than to using the same data over and over again, because using the same data will definitely get into that concept called overtraining that I will mention soon.
If I want to give the later data more significance, can I do that in that case? Because if you, the old data might not be so important and the newer one are more important. So.
How should I answer? Yes, theoretically you can actually, if you just continue training on the new data and you have a reality that changes, because that's what you're talking about here. Then a neural network will. Then first, I will sound like something positive here now. Yes, just train the neural network, and it will adapt to the changing world. If you have enough labeled training samples that are coming all the time, it will. But on the negative side, you should always be very careful when you're trying to adapt your method to a changing world, because the method may go astray, especially if it's an unsupervised case, or if you don't get labeled training data. Then you can use your trained neural network to label your data, fine, and then the world changes, and you try to learn the network, you try to learn it by its own labeled samples, and then the network might start diverging to something completely different. So it's never risk-free to retrain these in the run, especially if you have a real application. It might be too risky if you don't know that it will actually, the performance might not be stable. So there are a lot of more things to think about when you're doing that. Yes, now I will think what I will say in a while, because I will probably return to that, because I can attribute it to one thing I think is very, very important, which I will come to after the possibly short break, actually.
The question was also, are you going to go back again to this deep neural?
I'm thinking, because I hadn't planned to say so much about it, but maybe if there is time, maybe I can.
I
so I will keep it open.
Okay.
I suppose you would like me to, right? You would like to hear more about deep neural networks? Then I can maybe say I will make a digression about that when after the pause. Okay, so this is some understanding of the neural network paradigm, which can be described as trial and error. Try something, adjust the lines until you get it right. That is this backprop rule. No other questions about that? Then I will. Sorry, the.
What's the bad side?
The bad side. Yeah, of course I need to say something about the bad side. I would claim that they are actually, if you're not careful, they are prone to this concept of overtraining, that you get a method that are so much adapted to your training data that it will not generalize well to new data. And if you're not careful, you will fall into that trap. And because they are, there are so many ways, if you have several layers, you have so many degrees of freedom. So for example, in this picture, if you have a very many layers, you could have a discrimination region that looks like you train it, and then it looks like that, and like that. Did you get it? I should have drawn it, but then you fit exactly. You pick that one, you go out, you can pick that one, and you go out. And do you really think it looks like that? Because if you now get a new pattern here, and if you overtrain it like zoom, 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 then that one will be blue. But that gave the best result on the training data, so it must be like that. Not. So
there is a tendency of overfitting, basically.
That you must keep track about. And there is a lot of effort spent in the neural network community. You have test sets, validation sets, and you have various methods of to make sure that you don't fall in this trap. But the trap is very hard to get away from. Whatever you do, and I will talk about that a little later also, whatever you do, you will always think you get better results when you run it in your laboratory, even with test sets and validation sets, than you will get in the real world. And these are, I would say, extra prone to that. That is one thing to look out for. Yes, they require a lot of training data, as we said. Because they have such a lot of freedoms, they require a lot of training data, and that makes it sensitive to that, if you have too little data.
Would you also say that maybe one of the disadvantages is kind of black box? Because sometimes one topology works well, and other times other doesn't. More layers, less layers, more neurons, less neurons. And suddenly you have a configuration that works perfectly and you don't know why. This is one criticism I have heard about.
Yes, that's an important criticism. Indeed. Yeah. So I will move on to the statistical methods. And since this is my area, I will not say anything bad about it. But I can say that It's huge, actually. It's not one single method. There are so many methods that can be labeled statistical, especially since it's convergence, as I said, that everyone frames their method in statistical terms, because statistics is of course, a very versatile field. But the common idea you can identify here is that you have a probabilistic approach to it. So you're saying that you want to calculate the probability that a new pattern feature vector X here belongs to a certain class C. So that is a probabilistic approach as opposed to this logic approach when everything is in neat, hard boxes, of course, that you now are talking about probabilities. Nothing is certain, but you have more or less likely things. And then it all comes to how do you calculate this probability? And there are many different models that do that. You can have, I mentioned on the previous slide, maybe I should have copied it here, the mixture models, graphical models, Markov chains, a lot of different things.
Can you interpret the output of the last neuron as a probability if it's between 0 and 1?
Yes, indeed, that's what then, in this convergence between the fields, that is what people started doing, interpreting the output as a probability. And then selecting training rules that tries to make it equivalent to the probability also, because otherwise you can't just interpret it as a probability. So you need to train it like that. Yeah.
So I guess even the training labels could be probabilistic?
Or? Yes, they could. You can complicate it in any way you like, of course.
Because sometimes you might think that this orange on the right are nearly 100% orange, but orange towards the left can be a bit orange, a bit blue.
You can. In this, it's. Well, yeah.
It's not a training. But it doesn't help you. I mean,
now you have a negative opinion about probabilities. It is a clue if you say that this is with 70% probability. Well, if you have a disease that is less than 1% and you suddenly say there's a 50% chance that this is a disease, that's a 50-fold hint. So you never underestimate probabilities. Remember, probabilities and uncertainties, that's not your enemy, that's your friend. You can make a lot of good conclusions by using probabilities. So yeah, now that's... I shouldn't... don't get me started on this. All right. Okay, one important difference here is also non-parametric versus parametric methods. That if you have something called the, remember the case-based methods in the beginning, they also have this probabilistic interpretation. You have a method called, for example, Parson Windows, that was rather early. Nowadays people would say kernel density estimators, if you have heard that thing. That is case-based method moved into the statistical domain, that you have, for each sample, you add a small Gaussian curve, for example, and then you add up the Gaussian curves for all samples. So then you get some kind of shape here, probabilistic density function over the whole space, and that is then your model that you classify the patterns with. And that's a typical non-parametric thing, because then you have no assumptions on the strange shape in your domain. It might look like everything if you have such an unparametric method. Whereas if you, as in my example with the lines here, we have assumed a simple Gaussian mixture. So here we have a model, a Gaussian mixture model, saying that the blue class is generated from one Gaussian, multivariate Gaussian, and the orange from another multivariate Gaussian, whereas the Gaussian has a mean and a standard, or a variance, a covariance vector actually, identified by these two standard deviations outline. So the farther away you are from this center in the steps to the outline kind of means that you are less likely to belong to that one. So in this case, I would say that the question mark is closer to the orange one in terms of the number of standard deviations, slightly closer. It's on the border, I would say.
And this is would be parametric.
And that is a parametric model.
Because you decided a priori.
Because you know what shape you expect, what distributions you expect. And of course, a parametric method might not be as limited as a Gaussian. It might be a Markov chain, which is rather free, a lot of parameters, but still parametric. Support vector machines, unparametric, yes. And also, I would say Markov chain Monte Carlo is a method more than a model, really, that is typically unparametric. Is it? Okay, it's, yeah, essentially, at least. And this is an important distinction, because again, it depends on, do you know anything about your space or don't you? Do you expect some shapes or not? If you know something about the shapes, you should typically use a parametric method, because you will get less overtraining and better precision. If you don't, you need to fall back on a non-parametric method, and then it doesn't matter.
Parametric, non-parametric, does it make sense when you talk about neural network or not? Or it's completely... No, but wait a minute. We just define under statistical...
It's very dangerous to ask those things to a researcher, because everything is related to everything else, but normally not. I would say a neural network is just it's a parametric model, but a very, very wide parametric model, so it can take a lot of different shapes. But then some people would say, well, you can introduce one so-called grandmother cell for each training pattern and increase the number of hidden units with each pattern. So you introduce new hidden units for every new pattern you see, then you have a non-parametric model. So you can make a neural network in the non-parametric way, but that is not what people typically do. So, what should I say about... I should say something more about statistical methods. Since it's such a general field, you can find anything there. So it's hard to say something that is positive for in the big data context or streaming data context, and something that is negative, because you always have some, each different statistical method have some drawbacks and some advantages, of course. But I would say that the parametric models have this advantage that if you have a lot of data, the models typically don't grow. So it doesn't matter how much data you get, you just update your parameters and can probably throw away the old training data, which is an advantage. Whereas the non-parametric ones that typically you have to store at least a subset of the training data, they might grow, if not linearly, at least slowly with the training data. Also, what can I say more? Maybe you can say more things. I will say one thing, actually. There is an assignment for today that you have got. And in that assignment, you are meant to actually implement a machine learning method of your own, maybe for the only time in your lives, because nowadays everyone just downloads ready packages and so on. I think it's important still to actually to understand what you are doing, to actually implement something yourself. Only then can you adjust an algorithm and extend it and so on. So that's why we will try to make you implement a simple machine learning method, and that is, of course, a statistical method we have selected, one of the simplest statistical machine learning methods there is, the so-called naive Bayesian classifier. So there are some statistics that you need, but we have explained that, I hope, sufficiently in the assignment. So if you read it carefully, it should not be, it might scare you at first if you are not used to the statistical notation, but read it carefully, try to get through it. I think we have put enough hints there, so in the end, it's not so much you need to do. I can just say something about this naive Bayesian classifier. Should I? No, it actually says very. It's more pedagogic in the assignment description. So maybe I let you read it there instead. But it's what I can say is that the naive Bayesian classifier makes a simplifying assumption. It assumes that each input feature is within each class is independent of the other features. That each look at it like this. Each input feature gives some hint about whether it is a class or it isn't. And that hint is independent of all the other hints from the other features. So you can just combine the hints by summing them up, more or less.
It means if you have a problem, you can first maybe do principal component analysis and then use naive Bayes, because that guarantees it.
Yes. If the data is multivariate Gaussian.
Yeah.
If it's not, if it's a sausage shape or a, then it's Gaussian. So you still have an assumption. But yeah, it makes it better. So that's the point. So you make this huge simplifying assumption that each hint is independent on the other hints about each hint about the class. Nevertheless, it has so few parameters, this thing, that it's many times this would be your first method of choice to try on a new problem. It might not be the best solution to a problem, but it might give surprisingly good result due to its simplicity. Because it has so few parameters that it's very robust against overtraining, kind of. Every method has a risk of overtraining, but this is more robust than many other methods, which means that you actually can train it even if you have a very small training set. So if you have a too small training set, this method will beat any other method. All the more advanced methods will just be underdetermined by your small data set, but this one can actually do something good about it. And then you say it will give, I claim, it give reasonably good results even if this independence assumption is not fulfilled, because this robustness makes that a more advanced model, if you not have sufficiently much training data, a more advanced model will get more wrong by overtraining. So naive Bayes might give a small error because it's not this assumption is not fulfilled, but it will be more robust, and that's the final result will be better. So naive Bayes, I can say a lot of good things about that. Always start with that one before you try another more advanced method. If it works, then maybe that's enough.
If you have a lot of data, does it work? Does it get better?
If you have a lot of data, then other methods might probably beat it. Because then you have the data to actually adjust a more complex shape of things. But you might, and this is something also I might say, you might think in this big data time that you always have a lot of data. But you don't. When you start looking at it, you have some companies say, oh, we have so and so many gigabytes of data you can have. And then you start dividing it in different entities, like if we have ship data, we have a big database of ship movements, for example, a lot of boats, ships, boats around Sweden. We have so and so much data. Yeah, but of each kind of ship, there's a lot of different kinds, 108 different kinds of ships. And going at this specific region in Sweden during this specific time period, doing a certain maneuver, and then suddenly you just have two or three such ships, although you had this 10 gigabytes of data to start with. So when you start dividing it down in different categories, different types, you always end up with too little data. That might be a surprise to you. But so that's why naive Bayes still makes sense in a big data context. And also it's good, missing data is the same, of course, if you have a lot of missing data, noisy data, like in the real world. I think that so far, I have covered the different paradigms of machine learning, very on the surface, of course. Oh gosh, it's time that much. I've been talking a lot. So we will not have a break, but I will make a mental break here, kind of. This is my first part, and then I will cover a second part, which everything around machine learning. Selecting the method is not everything. So now I will take a number of other steps that you need to think about in machine learning. And the first thing, the reason I have taken so long time to come here is that I have made digressions already about these things that I will say in the second part. So one thing is about representation. As we said, there was one question about, does it make sense to test different machine learning methods on a certain problem? And my more complete answer would actually be, many times, indeed, it is not critical what machine learning method you use, or even paradigm. Several paradigms might solve the same problem. It's more critical what representation you use, what features you select. If you select the wrong features to feed to your method, no method will work. If you happen to pick the relevant features, the features that actually give some hints about the classes, then it again doesn't matter. All methods will make it. So it's more important to select a good feature representation than to select a certain method. And let's see what I can say. This is what it says here on this slide, by the way. And again, why is it so important to find a good representation? It's because if you have a good representation, a simple model like naive Bayes, for example, might be quite sufficient. And then you said, can you use principal components? Yes, this is a perfect way of selecting your representation. Instead of feeding in the original attributes, try to make them independent with principal components, like a pre-processing step, and then use that, and maybe you can use a simpler model. And when I say, then I say, this is important because the number of parameters should always be kept low to get good generalization. So try to keep it simple if you can. The negative side is, of course, that to find a suitable representation requires a lot of domain knowledge and understanding of your problem. So there is no black box solutions. Regardless of which method you use, you must understand what you are doing and what is the suitable things to feed in. There are different methods, and like always, in in some cases that there are tools, information theoretic tools, for example, like the ones, the mutual information that I mentioned with regard to logical inference, that can hint you which features are the relevant ones. If you already have a set of possible features that you think that among these are the relevant ones. But then there are cases when you can just not select among the existing. You must completely transform the space to something else to get it relevant. I think there is one example. Yes, this is my favorite example of that one. So now I have to tell you another anecdote here. The neural network fields has had its up and downs, its hypes and dips. And one of those dips were caused by this book in 1969. Then we were just in the middle of a neural network hype. But at that time, most neural networks were only one layer, single layer neural networks. So they could only do this straight discrimination lines and so on. And then Minsky and Papert wrote this very famous book on perceptrons, the one-layer perceptrons typically, these neural networks, and explain a lot of things they couldn't do. And people went like, oh, don't they solve all our problems? Oh no, then they are worthless, and gave up the field. And the funding vanished overnight, more or less. So when this book came out, it almost killed the neural network field, and it was dead for 15 years, or more than 15 years, until I think, was it 86? There were 84, somewhere there. Yes, secretly with the small funding they had. and suddenly, someone actually managed to find this algorithm for a multi-layer perceptron, the multi-layer neural network. And it certainly didn't solve all problem, that algorithm, because it still had problem with local minima and vanishing weights if you want to have more hidden layers and so on. Problems that has now been a little bit better solved than at that time. But still, when people realized that they could overcome the simple limitations of here, they went like, oh yeah, now we have a method that can solve all problems again. So then there was a new hype in neural networks for a while. But anyway, from 86 and forward. And then it abated again, and now we're in this deep learning hype when everyone thinks that deep learning will now solve all the problems, and that's also a hype, but it does something very important, certainly. So deep learning, I think, is an important achievement. People just tend to overinterpret these things and think that now we have solved all the problems. No, we haven't, but it is a real achievement. Now we can do a lot of more advanced things than a few years ago. So, but what I should say about this thing is that this book is unfairly treated, because it's a very good book. It tells exactly what is wrong with the one-layer networks. It gives clear hints on where to proceed and how to solve it. But people probably didn't read that far. They gave up after the first part. So. But for example, what I like to say about representation is that on the front cover of this book, there are these two pictures, because they prove that there are some predicates, some logical predicates that you can't solve with a one-layer neural network. And one is the connected predicate. If you have a picture with a figure, and you want to ask yourself, is this figure connected? Is it a one-piece figure or not? And you feed the picture in as a number of black and white pixels, or red and green pixels is in this case, to a one-layer neural network. There is no neural network that can distinguish those two classes. You cannot train with showing a lot of connected pictures and a lot of unconnected pictures. And that is true. But the thing is that this picture in the beginning should be a warning sign that so can't we easily. Our first layer perception can't. One of these pictures is connected, the other is not. And it's not that you see it immediately. You have to trace it sequentially to actually figure it out. So a single neural network which just takes a picture as a snapshot, and of course can't do it, because the pixels themselves are not relevant. It's the entire connectivity of the lines on a global scale. There is a small, small difference in the middle. 4 pixels here in the middle are different between these two pictures, and they make the whole difference. You have seen which one is connected and which one is not.
The above one is connected.
The above one is not connected. Yeah. So this is a very good example of images. When you want to analyze images, the representation is critical, because the pixels themselves doesn't give any hint to these global properties of the picture. And that is, by the way, what is so important now with this this hype around deep learning networks, because I could stop here and say that this is why you have to select the features. You must realize if it's an image recognition problem, you should not feed in the pixels. You must feed in some more higher level features. And then someone could say rightly that that's exactly what you try to do with deep neural networks, at least the kind of neural network called convolutional neural network. Because then you have actually coded into the neural network these kind of invariances present in an image, that the exact position of a line is not important. The existence of a line somewhere in the picture is more important than that it is at those pixels or those or those. That doesn't matter. So it's and you build in by that domain knowledge that you know that it's a picture and you know what invariances holds. With invariance, I haven't talked much about what that means, but it is, that means exactly that the picture is still connected if you translate it to the left or the right or up and down. So that you can change every single pixel in the picture and it's still connected. So no single pixel on its own tells anything about the connectivity. And that is because of this translation invariance. And by taking care of that in a convolutional neural network, you get something that actually works very well for image recognition, that actually beats most other methods currently. And that answers two different things. It answers why is it important with representation and understanding what kind of problem you have and what kind of invariances you have, and it also answers what is so special about this deep learning now, what was the thing they solved. And I claim they have come, it's this, invariances is part of the answer. A more general answer is representation. They realize that you have to have several layers of more and more abstract representation to actually solve something. You can't just input the raw primitive things. You must build up more advanced representations to do really advanced results. Yeah, so that's okay. I will continue. Next thing you need, so now I think I gave you this impressive representation. It's really, really important. The next thing is data cleaning. That is, it takes, I think that this first thing, the data cleaning, getting the data and understanding the data, so maybe these two together will take up to more than 90, maybe 95% of the time in a typical machine learning project of real-world data is consumed by this part. The machine learning part is simple. You just download a package from somewhere and run it. But this is a hard thing. So, for example, real data, in real data, typically missing data, fields might have come completely corrupt or in wrong columns or wrong everything. If it's free text, it might be misspellings. Some magic values might be used. Clearly, a temperature of -9999, that's not a realistic temperature. So we can safely use that value to represent something else. Yeah, and then someone takes this data and tries to do linear regression on it. So, of course, other kind of noise in the data, typically values that we can see. Sensors that are supposed to, for example, these are all real things we encountered. This sensor was supposed to give something between 0 and 100%, and somehow there seems to be an offset. This might be always a problem if you try to merge different sources that are slightly different representations. Or suddenly change the interpretation of the database that happens. You want to ask for data from some company, and they say, "Yeah, we have data from 2010, but we changed the system slightly in 2012, so it doesn't mean exactly the same, and we reuse the same columns, but change the meaning of the columns and so on. Inconsistencies, of course. And then, of course, do you really get the right data? That happens very many times when we get data that they give us a lot of data, and most of it is not. Sometimes there is actually the columns that would have been important and relevant are not there. They have just they took the ones they thought were relevant and missed the real ones. For example, this is just an example of what this is like a mashup of different strange things that I put together in one slide. So all these strange things has not occurred in the same data, but we have seen all. This is very, for example, typical periods that just seem to be in the wrong place. How can this occur? Or missing period? It might either be from an OCR or someone manually trying to writing in the numbers in the computer. I can't realize how it could happen otherwise.
It's
but
releasing.
We have seen this. Yes, we got this kind of data. Another thing is, of course, this is a timestamp, the year, month, day, clock, and suddenly there are some data from 1858. So this computer science is quite older than you might think. And then, of course, this is these magic numbers that means something else. Either it means just undefined, but it also means it might mean something else. And here is another attribute, a thing that you think would be a numerical attribute, and suddenly it says overflow or just error. And then what should you do with it? Either you can treat it as missing data, just remove it, this is missing. Or maybe it means something, maybe it's significant. Maybe there is a difference between overflow and error, for example, in the process data. Do we need to consider it, or should we just throw it away? So, and then natural language, I don't have to comment on all the different things you can say the same thing by different strings. So this is a thing you need to handle. And that's it on data cleaning. And it takes a lot of time. Any questions so far, or I will, yeah. I can't answer what the best practice is because it differs from case to case. You need to understand. You need actually to understand, is it significant? Maybe I should divide this column in two columns, and one column is the numerical value, and it is unknown when it was this kind of string. And then you have a discrete column, which is unknown in the other cases and has the value 1 here and value 2 here or something, then you don't throw away the possibly significant indication that something has gone wrong. So you still maintain the data. That is probably the most general thing. But the other answer is it must be connected to what do you do with missing data. If you have one row with one missing attribute in it, would you throw it away entirely, the entire row? Or can you use the rest of the columns even if one of them are unknown? That depends on the method. And then I say, naive Bayes can handle the other columns even if one of them is unknown. But for example, a neural network, then you would have to fill it in with this. There are various methods to impute missing data. But they will kind of corrupt the data. That is, whatever way you have to fill in missing data will corrupt the data. You can never guarantee that you get it right. So that's a very big issue by itself, how to handle missing data, which I will not go further into again. Some methods are better than others. I will go on to validation. I already touched on the questions here. I touched on overtraining, the concept of overtraining, that if you have a training data set and then a distinct test data set, you might fit your model, if the model is, you might fit the model too well to the training data. So, like I tried to show with this line, that you could, which was it? Yeah, you could make a line here very, very neatly fitting all the training data, but there is no guarantee that it makes sense on new patterns, because the training data is necessarily noisy, and you should not overinterpret that noise to try to learn exactly that specific noise, because then you are in a very bad shape when you get real data. For example, if you have, as I said, 2 relevant attributes and 10 irrelevant, completely noisy attributes, there, and you have a, even if you have a pretty large data set, you might always find some hints in that complete noise to perfectly learn the class labels. But that is, when you get new data, that is completely invalid, the noise, so you will just make guesses, kind of. And so that is, and this is a real risk with all machine learning, but some machine learning methods are more prone to this than others. And that is why I say, keep it as simple as you can, because the more parameters you have, the higher is the risk of overtraining. On the other hand, you cannot not have it too simple, because then you can't represent the things you need to do. So it must be advanced enough to be able to represent the real world, but not more than that. And then you need sufficient training data to actually, if you have too little training data, it will overtrain. Let's see, so what you do, typically what you do is to use, to make sure that you don't have overtraining. When you try to develop your method, you keep one training set and one validation set. And then you train it on your training set, and then to make sure that you haven't overestimated, then you will get a very good result. 96% right. And then you test it on your validation set, and they say, oh no, only 79%. But that's a more realistic measure then. So those 79%, that's the one you can trust, not 96 as you got on your training data. That represents your overtraining, kind of.
So nowadays, with all this deep learning methods and big data and what you're training, is there an issue with overtraining, or did this never reach this point? Can you overtrain deep learning?
It's more complicated than that, just answer yes or no. Deep neural networks, yes, there is an issue of overtraining of those, definitely, I would say. They are learning some features, but not necessarily the ones you expected them to learn. So there is an issue, indeed. It's less of an issue if you have a lot of data, but still, deep learning networks requires huge amounts of data to actually avoid overtraining. So you are developing things in your lab, and then there is another way. I will answer in the next what I will say now partly answers your thing. That overtraining, this is just one way when you think that you will handle overtraining. But then when I say this, there are unimaginably many ways that make the result look better in the laboratory than in real life. That is, ways in which overtraining might creep in. So consider this. Consider that you have some training set, and you keep out a validation set to see how good it is. So you train your method, your backprop neural network, and you test it on the validation set. Oh, only 79%. Okay, let's try a decision tree. So you train your decision tree on the training set, test it on the validation set. 81%. Now we're onto something. Try a statistical machine learning method and on the same training set, test on the validation set, now we have 84%. That's overtraining. Now we have used the same validation set over and over again to compare different machine learning methods. Of course you will select the machine learning method that gives the best result on your validation set, not on all the samples in the world. So it has creeped in information about the specific noise and peculiarities in your validation set has crept into this method development, although you tried to not do that. So if you have a validation set, you can only use it only once. Then you need to get a new validation set for the new method, or even if you try different parameters of your network. So, and consider this, the whole community uses benchmarks. So they download a benchmark to see how good their method is. Of course, that will produce a lot of publications about methods well suitable to solve exactly those benchmarks. That's overtraining. So, and so it goes on. So this is really, and you can read some people say that the support vector machines, for example, they were developed to actually counter overtraining. Vapnik and Soos tried to develop this method to not get it as prone to overtraining as some neural networks were. So he claimed, this is not prone to overtraining. But if you try it, it is. It does overtrain, nevertheless. So then someone, Bishop and et al., developed this statistical version of support vector machine, regression vector, I forgot what it is, RVM instead, anyway, and said that this is to avoid overtraining. Nevertheless, you can still observe overtraining with it, a little bit less, but still, it's still there. And it doesn't matter, you will have overtraining, so be careful. That's the point there. And I can't give you any way to solve this other than this, be careful, kind of. So, I already said this, things that will give you overtraining, too few data samples, too complicated model, fine-tuning your parameters until you get the best result, and so on. Finally, some words about deployment. When you think you are done, you probably want to use this in the real world. Take it out from the lab and use it in the real world. And there are other obstacles there to overcome. For example, now the method is on its own, so you can't help it, kind of. So it must be robust. Things will happen in the world that you didn't think about. Like we had some timestamps. We had a method just recently in a project which took the latest timestamp as the current time, and it evaluated an anomaly over all the seen data so far up to the current time, and then it waited for half an hour or so, and then it evaluated the anomalies and waited another half an hour, and then suddenly in this real data stream from this spring, there turns up a data sample labeled 2016. And our method, of course, stopped working. It stopped checking anomalies because it had only done it until 2016. So it would have been waiting there for more than a year before the next evaluation. Yeah, that kind of stuff. And also, you touched upon things that change. If you actually try to modify your network with a world that actually changes, because the world does change. So if you have trained your network or whatever method you have, and it gave you good results in the laboratory, and then you move it out to the real world, and the real world will start drifting. After a while, then your network or method will not give as good results anymore. And then someone says, we can retrain it continuously. Yeah, but be careful, because as I said, if you do it the wrong way, your network will kind of diverge out in the blue in its own fantasies. So,
could you then maybe, is it possible to relate what you say with this drifting reality, that is the difference with the parametric and non-parametric models? that if it is parametric, it's easier to capture the drift than or there is no clear
again, the answer is more complicated than I can give it easily. It's not immediately related. It can be a problem for both parametric and non-parametric. I can't immediately see which one is easier, actually. Mm-hmm. So it's be prepared to go all over the process again. You think you made this good thing that works in the laboratory, and then you get out to the real world, and you're essentially at scratch. You need to do all the steps again, kind of. So document carefully what you do in the beginning, because you will have to do it again. that's essentially it. Let's see if I have some... So this is the kind of picture. This is... how much effort different steps take. And as I said, the methods themselves are not so much. Data cleaning is a lot, and actually deployment is a lot of things around it. And I think I have some conclusions as well. So these would be my main conclusions from this thing. Thoroughly understand the problem. There are no black box solutions. You actually need to understand what you want to do and select a method that is suitable and take care of all these things. Is it too complicated model? Is the data too much? Is the features right? Everything. Does it drift? Then make sure to select a suitable representation or select a method that helps you select this representation, whatever. But be aware that you can't just take the raw data and let the method do it. You need to know what the relevant stuff is to feed into your machine learning method. And as I said, take extreme care with validation and evaluate it on new data and real world data. That's something I didn't say, but I don't trust simulated data. After we had one project we couldn't get real data, so we got simulated data to train some classification. We trained it on the simulated data, and then we had a short snippet of real data, and it didn't look one thing like the simulated. It was so different, you can't imagine. It's not... So use real data. Don't trust simulated data. There are so many complications in the real data that are not there in the simulated data. Noise, peculiarities, things. And yeah, keep it as simple as possible. But of course, it must be powerful enough to solve the problem you have. But given that, don't overkill it. Just the simpler it is, the more likely it is that it actually will work in reality. That's it.
Did you say something? Did you say, are you going to comment on deep learning?
Yes, but I did, but very briefly. Okay, so what is to repeat it. The important thing with deep learning is this, that you try to build representations on a higher level. So it is connected to this finding suitable representations, and it is connected specifically to this image recognition, then this is invariances that try to build up these things. I will not have time to go into even more depth, unfortunately. There is a lot to say about it, but yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
First, thank you.